Good evening, everybody. Welcome, Women's Common Room Club members, friends of Women's Common Club, Women's Common Room Club members, All Souls members, and friends of All Souls members, right? I am very proud tonight that Belfast was nominated got seven nominations in the Oscars, which I think is superb. So I think it's a night for celebrating that. My daughter, who lives in London, saw Belfast, and what she said was, it reminded her of why you loved Belfast, but it also reminded her of why she left Belfast. There you are, right? This is the second event we have held in All Souls this year, the year of 2021 to 2022. The last was our memorable Christmas celebration, where we had magnificent singing by David Durham and Katie Neary, and wonderful piano accompaniment and solos from the All Souls musical director, Trevor Gillam. I would like to remind you that we in the Women's Common Room Club would be very grateful if you made a small donation to the church for their generosity in letting us use this church again while our room in Queen's is unavailable. It does, however, also seem so appropriate to have a talk on art in this beautiful building. And by the way, the donation box is at the bottom of the center aisle, really at the very back of the church. Chris, would you like to speak?
No,
Excuse me. I have invited the Reverend Chris Hudson, the minister of All Souls Church, to welcome you.
I'm actually the right reverend.
Oh, he's the right reverend. Sorry. Is that the moderator, yes?
For 1 year, I will be the right reverend, and then I'll be the wrong reverend after that. Anyway, you are very, very welcome. And by the way, if you cannot make a small donation, you can always make a large donation. But you're very, very welcome. And again, it's wonderful for All Souls to be associated with the Queen's Women's Common Room Club. I think this is about the second, but definitely it could be the third or the fourth event that we've been associated with you. So you're very welcome to All Souls. We're delighted to have you here, and we hope to keep up the relationship with your club and All Souls. And I know Carol mentioned the film Belfast. If you haven't seen it, go and see it. Absolutely wonderful film. A great credit to Sir Kenneth Branagh. And I hope he wins all the Oscars, Emmys, and Brit Awards, everything, because it's a great credit to him. And Carol said about her daughter that it reminded her of why she loved Belfast, but why she left Belfast. Well, as a Dubliner, can I say, it reminds me of why I came to live in Belfast. You're great people, and it's a great place. Enjoy.
Thank you, Chris. Right, so tonight, like the last event, is another artistic event, a talk on painting, probably the most famous painting in the world, the Mona Lisa by Leonardo da Vinci. Tonight, Dr. Isabella Evangelisti will be explaining what makes it such a great painting. After all, we all know of people, maybe ourselves included, who have seen the Mona Lisa in the Louvre and have said, "Is that it? What's all the fuss about that very small picture?" So Isabella will explain to us what is great about this picture. This is the fourth talk Isabella has given to the Women's Common Room Club. Her first talk was The Nude in Irish Art, and the second was Women in Irish Art, Part 1, and was followed in 2019 by Part 2. Being asked to return is an indication of how much we have enjoyed each of Isabella's talks. Anyway, before saying any more about Isabella, please bear with me while I address a few things to the Women's Common Room members. First, I just wanted to say that our book group is thriving and has thrived through the pandemic, right? We met last Tuesday, just after Holocaust weekend. Our chosen book was The Passenger, which is a book about the growth of anti-Semitism in 1938 in Nazi Germany. Our awareness had been raised by the programmes on the Holocaust Day, and we had a very active and a very moving discussion. I actually felt it was the best book group I'd ever been at, right? It was really, really very good. For anybody's information, our next book is Small Things Like These by Claire Keegan, right? It's a book about women in Ireland. Now, then our next talk of the Women's Common Room is our annual celebration of International Women's Day. And we've invited Dawn Purvis, a strong and brave woman who can and has dealt with controversies and faced them head on. Dawn's career has taken her from Northern Ireland politics. She was an MLA and a leader of the PUP. She then moved to deal with women, to head up an organisation dealing with women's health and reproduction rights. And today she's head of corporate affairs for a housing association. The title of her talk is I Love Northern Ireland. It seems to be the theme tonight, doesn't it? My Life and Peace Building. She also added, you can't have peace without social and economic justice. By the way, she's a good friend of Chris Hudson, and she is a former women's studies student of mine and Jerry Gribbins. So we know from personal experience that she's a very talented speaker. The meeting, if you want to take note, will be Tuesday, the 8th of March, and we'll be back in Queens, in the Senate room, not our usual room. I would love to extend this invitation to everyone here this evening, but unfortunately I can't, as Queens has very strict COVID rules about the numbers permitted in any single room. Okay, that's all my business done. So now for Isabella. Isabella Evangelisti. I'm sure you will agree with me that that is one of the most beautiful sounding names you've ever heard. A name that suggests a story. Her father was an Italian from Naples, fought in the Italian army, captured in Ethiopia, then called Abyssinia, and taken as a prisoner of war to India. At the end of the war, he returned to Italy and resumed his career as a violinist. He then moved to Dublin to be a violinist in the Radio Éireann Orchestra. So that explains why this Evangelisti has a Dublin accent. And the next question is, why then is this dub living in Belfast, right? Well, she is in Belfast because she met Chris, who you've just heard, her husband, at events and move was to promote liberal ideas in the Republic. They moved to Belfast about 15 years ago when Chris retired from being a trade union boss to take up ministry of this church. They both are still very active in the promotion of liberalism and tolerance here in the north today. They look at welfare, the welfare and rights of, they help, sorry, immigrants with welfare and their rights, and they also support LGBT rights and marriage equality and many other things. Isabella is also a scholar. She has had two books published, The Nude in Modern Irish Art, and the Unitarian Church in Dublin, an architectural and social history. I found my old notes for Isabella's third lecture to us, and I'm going to repeat them for this, her fourth talk. What I said was, her talk is academic but accessible to all, deep and informed but not cluttered with detail, serious but also entertaining and engaging. All Isabella's talks have met this description, and I'm sure tonight's will too. So over to Isabella. Thank you, Isabella.
No pressure then, Carol. Now, can everybody hear that okay? Yeah? Is that better? Alistair? Yes, testing. Sorry, folks. Is that okay now? That I can hear it myself now. So is that okay? The other thing I would ask you to do, maybe Chris, is turn off the blow heaters? Right, I think everybody can hear me now. And are you comfortable with lights off? Because you'll see the images much better with the lights off. Chris, can we have the lights down, please? Thank you. Okay, is everybody comfortable like that? Yeah. Okay, let's get started. You can see from the title slide that I've given my talk an official and an unofficial title. The official one being the sort of academic sounding one, Leonardo da Vinci and the Renaissance Italian Portrait. But really what I'm asking is the second title, What's So Great About the Mona Lisa? Because it is the most famous painting in the world. And contrary to what Carol says, I'm not going to tell you that it's great. I'm not going to tell you why it should be the most famous painting in the world. I'm going to try and extrapolate a bit of the mystery that surrounds it. And in the end, you have to decide for yourself whether it is or isn't. I should also say at this point, I'm not an expert by any means on Leonardo da Vinci, or indeed on the Italian Renaissance. I'm a very general kind of art historian, but my interest in paintings is in what moves us in paintings, what paintings tell us about what it is to be human, about what it feels like to be in this world, and how to be a human being. To me, if paintings don't contribute to that, I pass them by and look at something else. That's my approach to art. I'm not one of those experts that go into enormous detail about brush strokes although I'm an art historian, I'm notoriously bad about dates. So I will say that to get myself off the hook right from the beginning. Now, the Mona Lisa, La Gioconda, it's sometimes called, was painted probably in 1503 to 1507 by Leonardo da Vinci. Everybody knows that, right? Hands up if you've been to see it. Quite a few. Hands up if you were disappointed. Yeah, quite a few. And that's the problem, because if you have made that trek to the Louvre, I hope you went to see something else on that day as well, because what you'll have experienced is this. And along with all of the 6 million viewers who queue up to see her every year because of the extent of the fame of this painting. Frankly, it's not a very edifying experience. Firstly, because it's a small painting, and she's behind a sheet of bulletproof glass. And secondly, because of the hordes of tourists that surround her. So usually all you see is a sea of cameras. However, let's just have a look at the picture. I'm going to examine this picture and the details and circumstances that surround it. I'm not going to give you a life of Leonardo da Vinci. To see what it is about the picture that has intrigued people for over 500 years. It's one of only 10 surviving paintings by Leonardo. And in a recent poll, 86% of people thought it the most famous painting in the world. However, most of the information about the painting is uncertain or debated, or at the very best, educated guesswork. The date shown on the slide is a guesstimate. It could have been painted anywhere between 1498 and 1515. The identity of the sitter is also debated. She has variously been supposed to be a noblewoman or a courtesan. And that's simply because at that time, only a noblewoman or a courtesan would have been painted. Ordinary women were not painted. The title Mona Lisa comes from the generally accepted identification of the sitter as Lisa Giocondo, born Lisa Gherardini, and she was formerly referred to, because she was a married woman, as Madonna Lisa, shortened in Italian to Mona Lisa and anglicized to Mona Lisa. This supposition that it is she in the painting comes from the fact that Leonardo's biographer Vasari, Giorgio Vasari, tells us that Leonardo painted a portrait of the wife of a Florentine nobleman named Francesco del Giocondo. And he then goes on to extol the praises of this painting in the highest terms. However, we don't know for sure if this was the painting that Vasari was talking about in his book, because, of course, his book had no pictures being written at that time. So assuming it is Lisa Giocondo, she was born in Florence in 1479, and at the age of 15, she was married to Francesco Giocondo, who was a 35-year-old, twice-widowed silk merchant with two children. That's a sign of the times as well. His life will be quite documented, being a nobleman and a businessman. Hers will probably only have the date of her birth and baptism, the date of her marriage, and the date of her death. So that's a problem in identification. She and her husband were still alive when Giorgio Vasari wrote his account of Leonardo's life in 1550. And they had built a new house in 1503, which might well have been the reason for commissioning a painting such as this. It's a small picture. It measures 77 by 53 centimetres. That's 31 by 21 inches, just short of. And it's painted in oil on wooden panel. Its colours have faded and the varnish has darkened over time. And the darkened varnish, I'll draw your attention to again later. It's quite significant in how dull the picture looks. It has never in its life been restored, and restoration in itself is a controversial issue, but it hasn't been touched. There's a little damage. A crack was discovered in 2004, but otherwise she's doing okay. After over 500 years, she's in pretty good nick. Now, Leonardo da Vinci was the illegitimate son of a notary, and he was born in Anciano, this beautiful little hill village near Vinci in Tuscany. And that's why he's known as Leonardo da Vinci, which simply means Leonardo from Vinci. He was born, we are told, that's the register of his birth there on the screen, on April 15th, in the third hour of the night. And he was described as an uomo senza lettere, which means he was not classically educated. He never learnt Latin. But he was very well educated in a general, if not an academic, way. In the 1460s, Leonardo went to Florence, 30 miles away from his hometown. And there he studied in the workshop of the artist Andrea del Verrocchio. His greatest patron was Lorenzo de' Medici, called Lorenzo the Magnificent because of his enormous wealth and of his lavish patronage of the arts. The Medici were a family of bankers and textile importers and manufacturers. They had the largest bank not only in Italy but in Europe, and were thought to be at that time the wealthiest family in Europe. The dynasty was started by the grandfather Cosimo, then the son Piero. Lorenzo was the grandson. So by this stage, his wealth was immense, and his patronage of the arts reflected that, as did his house, as you can see here from the exterior view of his palazzo and the interior courtyard. Aside from being bankers and cloth merchants, the Medici, through their control of the Signoria, were de facto rulers of Florence during what was the city's golden age for art and artists. His palazzo, which you see here, was designed by Michelozzo for Cosimo, the grandfather. This is a painting by Andrea del Verrocchio, Leonardo's master, with whom he went to study. And in a Renaissance workshop, the master taught the apprentices by introducing them to the simpler elements of painting first, such as backgrounds, drapery, trees, rocks, that kind of thing, before ever letting them loose on figural work. In this way, the master style, in this case Verrocchio, was absorbed and assimilated by the pupils, who then went on to have their own careers. The master would also put his own finishing touch to everything that left the studio so that it looked like it came from his studio. But it was, in a sense, a collaborative work. The idea of the artist as an individual genius simply didn't exist at this stage. Our later understanding of the very artist we're looking at today, of Leonardo, was part of the emergence of that idea much later in the 19th century. And we'll come to that indeed. Indeed, there is a myth, I would suggest it's only a myth, that Leonardo's talents as a pupil were so precocious that Verrocchio stopped painting when he saw how Leonardo's talents surpassed his own. Now, this painting is often quoted in art books because it's a work by Verrocchio, but the angel on the left is documented to have been painted by Leonardo. So this is, in fact, his first foray into painting the figure. Like all artists' workshops at the time, Verrocchio's produced not only paintings, but suits of armor, jewelry, heraldic devices, tombstones, anything, in fact, that was required for the betterment of the environment or the decoration of palaces or houses. So artists were initiated in painting, sculpture, and metalwork and had to be adaptable. In Verrocchio's workshop, Leonardo was encouraged not to over-specialize and to learn by experimentation. And this was a thing that he carried to its epitome in his own artistic practice. And by 1477 then, having completed his training with Verrocchio, he went on to have his own studio. Leonardo's first portrait was of Ginevra de Benci, a married woman whose portrait was commissioned by Bernardo Bembo. He was the Venetian ambassador to Florence in celebration of his platonic love for her. Now, this kind of portraiture is very typical of courtly love, a medieval idea which was characterized by playfulness and chivalry. Part of the game, as it were, of courtly love was the little puns included. In this case, it's a pun on the woman's name. Her name is Ginevra, and the tree behind her is juniper, or ginepro in Italian. So it's a way of identifying the sitter in a lyrical and poetic way. What I'm doing here now is I'm going to look at a series of female portraits by Leonardo, just to see the context in which he was working and the methodologies he had in female portraiture. In 1481, Leonardo moved to Milan, where he would spend the next 20 years. His patron there was Ludovico Sforza, Duke of Milan, known as Il Moro. Now, Leonardo craved court patronage because it would give him the freedom to indulge his interest in engineering, which probably surpassed his interest in painting. He wanted to make machines which would be used for the defense of the city and in warfare. In his enthusiasm to work for Ludovico, Leonardo wrote an application letter, and in it he says, and I quote, "I can build bridges and battering rams, secret passages, covered wagons behind which soldiers can hide. I can carry out sculptures in marble, bronze, or clay, and also I can do in painting whatever may be done, as well as any other, be he who he may." So he's really trying to big himself up to get a job, and it was successful, and he was employed by Ludovico. His talents weren't limited, as he says himself, to military engineering, sculpture and painting. He even designed the heating system for the palace and composed music for court. Now, Ludovico is seen here in a very, a kind of staid portrait, and it was very typical of the time, where it's part of a much larger picture, where people are seen in profile. And you can see opposite him is Beatrice d'Este, his wife, also seen, and this is a miniature, in profile. And that's very important for the context of Leonardo's portraiture, this side view. You can also see that Beatrice has quite elaborately dressed hair and makeup and clothing, as you would expect of a noble woman being depicted in a painting. Now, Leonardo's greatest ambition was his proposed monument to Francesco Sforza, Ludovico's father. Leonardo wanted to cast in bronze a statue of Francesco mounted on a rearing horse. This had never been done before and would have been a really revolutionary feat. His master, Verrocchio, who he was keen to be seen to surpass, had cast a huge equestrian statue of Bartolomeo Colleone in Venice, but it was the horse had all feet on the ground. It wasn't a rearing horse, and that was the challenge that Leonardo wanted to take on. So you can see his drawing here for the project on the left, and on the right, this very detailed drawing for an elaborate wooden shuttering system that Leonardo designed for the casting of the bronze horse's head. However, this never happened, and it never happened because the bronze that was to be used in the manufacture of the statue was used instead for cannon, so it was never completed. And in fact, a rearing equestrian statue on a large scale was not achieved in sculpture until the 17th century. So it was, like a lot of Leonardo's designs, way beyond the technology of the day, but well within the scope of his thinking and his genius. This is a portrait of Ludovico Sforza's mistress, Cecilia Gallerani. The ermine, the animal she's holding is an ermine, and it's a symbol of Sforza purity, supposedly, and modesty. I don't think there was very much really that we'd call modest about Ludovico Sforza, but apparently he was very fastidious about cleanliness and he ate very sparingly. So once again, like the last portrait we saw where the tree punned on the woman's name, in this case the ermine functions as a play on the woman's name. Gallerani is her name, and Galle is ermine in Greek. So it's a very kind of affected, erudite, kind of little playful reference to the sitter in the portrait. The painting also features another new device by Leonardo, which is the pose, and it's called a contrapposto. In both the woman and the animal. And that simply means that while the body, the shoulders are facing one way, the head is turned to face another. Sometimes in a full figure, you get very elaborate contrapposto poses where the lower half of the body is facing one way and there's a complete twist. This is just a simple twist of the head. And it just enlivens the portrait so much more, making it look as if perhaps she's just turned to gaze at somebody who's come into the room. Now, Leonardo was on the move again in 1499 when the French defeated Ludovico Sforza and he lost his powerful patron. So he went instead to Mantua. Now, Italy, as I'm sure you know, was at this time not Italy, but it was divided into city-states. each one ruled by a ruling family. And we're meeting them all as we travel with Leonardo through Renaissance Italy. We have the Medici, the Sforza, the Este, the Gonzaga, etc. And he's really traveling from one to the other, looking for patronage. Isabella d'Este was the Marchioness of Mantua through her marriage to Francesco Gonzaga. And she was the sister-in-law of the woman we've just seen in the miniature, Beatrice Sforza. Isabella and Francesco had a quite happy marriage for a dynastic marriage, but she experienced difficulty with becoming pregnant. It was 4 years before she had her first child, which was somewhat alarming to her, apparently. Eventually, they had 8 children, but she waited 4 years for her first pregnancy and several more years for the all-important male heir. And Isabella wrote a lot of letters, and so it's known that this caused her great anxiety. This drawing was completed in 1500. And her son, the same year her son Federico was born. And there has been speculation that in the drawing she is pregnant, probably because of the position of her hands on her stomach and the date. So again, it's a supposition, but it's a realistic one. Isabella d'Este is a subject for talk in her own right. She was an unbelievable woman. If Leonardo was the Renaissance man, this was the Renaissance woman. She was classically educated, she was gifted, she was a generous patron of the arts. In her husband's absence, when he went to fight a war, she became regent and governed better than he ever had. And again, she became regent before her son Federico came of age. And she ruled with ease and confidence. She was an amazing woman, way out of her time. And this is a drawing of her by Leonardo, but the painted portrait was never done. This was not uncommon, however, for Leonardo. He always abandoned things. He left many projects unfinished. Why? Well, he moved around a lot. He changed patrons a lot. He got bored. Very often, in his notebooks especially, there's a lot of working out of ideas, a lot of very frantic drawing of ideas. And once he's mastered a thing, he abandons it and moves on. So who knows why, but this painting was never painted. If it had been painted, and given how important a woman she was and how noble and rich a woman she was, one wonders, would he have added a headdress, jewelry, refinements and adornments to this very simple and very lovely drawing. Again, who knows? It's a possibility. Now, by 1500, Leonardo was back in Florence. The city was recovering from a period of religious fervor. A lot had happened in his absence. The Medici had fallen, been expelled by the fiery, reforming monks of Onorola. He himself was excommunicated in 1497 and burnt at the stake in 1498. So there had been a period of huge upheaval in Florence, and the Medici were gone. Leonardo now painted this Virgin and Child with Saint Anne on the left of your screen, probably for an order of monks, a religious order. Its composition features a very complex interrelated group of figures. So we no longer have that single female subject. We have two women and a child. Obviously, the Virgin, Saint Anne, and the child, the Christ child. Their interconnectedness as a group, if you look at those two women, it's impossible to tell where their bodies separate. It's impossible to tell how that mass would separate into two bodies. They really look like of a piece. This is full of symbolism. This interconnectedness of the figures symbolizes the idea of the Catholic Church as one body. And He represents the Virgin Mary and her mother, Saint Anne, as looking about the same age. Rather, the idea is to make them look ageless. The grandmother grasps the child protectively, but the mother, the Virgin, is much more relaxed. Now, this is taken to mean that she's relaxed about the child's fate. In other words, she doesn't intend in the fullness of time to stand in the way of the passion of Christ, and therefore the redemption of mankind. This idea of the Virgin Mary as a knowing participant in the unfolding of Christ's fate was central to the development of the cult of the Virgin Mary in the Catholic Church at that time. So it's very, very highly symbolic. Now, bearing in mind our interest is in the Mona Lisa, not in the Virgin Mary, what is important in these images is the centrality of the female figure. The philosophical ideas contained within it about womanhood and motherhood. Another thing you'll notice is the artist's intense interest in geology, in the landscape, in the rocky formations of those distant mountains, in both of the backgrounds. And in between them, there's this little bird's eye view of a landscape, which is just a little tiny little jotting that he did as a working out of an idea. The image on the right, if you look at it, has an even more extreme mountainous landscape in the background. There's a very symbolical reason for these motifs. An untouched barren land, clear light, and cool mist frequently occurred in Marian prayers as metaphors for Mary. Now, I would draw your attention in both of these paintings to the colours and that beautiful light, luminous blue in the background. And bear that in mind when you look at the Mona Lisa, that this is how the colours should look. The varnish has darkened and blurred these beautiful colours that you see in these two examples. So we're back to our own Lady Lisa. By 1503, Leonardo was back in Florence, penniless and with no patron. And so after all of this peripatetic wandering around Italy and experimental painting, it was then that he was probably commissioned to paint the wife of the prosperous merchant Francesco del Giocondo. Here she is. She sits in a chair on a balcony, overlooking an imaginary rocky landscape. She wears a very simple dress and veil, so there are no clues to her identity, like we saw with the tree, with the ermine. There's nothing like that. Otherwise, her status would normally be conveyed by her clothing and her jewellery, her complicated hairstyle and luxurious clothing. All of that has been taken away. So he's reduced it right down to essential elements. Painter has not given us any clues as to who this woman is. There are no attributes either, and none of the puns or plays on her name that we saw in the earlier portraits. Now, unhelpfully, there's no preliminary sketch existing for this painting, and very unusually for Leonardo, no mention of it in his notebooks. It was identified, or one like it, was identified by the biographer Giorgio Vasari, and he noted that it took 4 years to complete. In fact, Vasari, writing in 1547, said it was unfinished. So was it, in fact, never finished? And why is it considered such a masterpiece? Well, in the terms of its day, in artistic terms, it's considered a masterpiece because of the originality of the pose, the originality of the technique, the painting technique, And there's a very important word, which is sfumato, which I'll get onto in a minute. The contrapposto pose, facing the painter or the viewer, not looking sideways. And the way that she is set into the landscape, we don't see any window frame or anything. It's like as if she is part of the landscape. And ultimately then, its fame at the time derived from its naturalism. Now, we live in an age when we are used to the photographic image. We're used to everything being conveyed exactly to us. But artists in previous centuries took a long time of learning of technique to convey naturalism. And so something that looked as lifelike as this to contemporary audience seemed completely astonishing. That is how portraits would have been painted before. That's the typical pose of the time before Leonardo. This is Piero della Francesca, portrait of Federico di Montefeltro and his wife, another Sforza. This seigneurial portraiture in side profile, once you've looked at Leonardo, seems staid and old-fashioned. It seems lifeless. And this traditional pose derived ultimately from coins. Roman emperors, Greeks before them, would have been depicted on coins in a strict side profile. But Leonardo's method, his poses, are much more lifelike. Now, I mentioned the word sfumato. And sfumato is a kind of blurriness. And it was created by Leonardo by building up the paint in very, very thin, translucent layers from light to dark. So going over and over and over. What it does, it's a very time-consuming technique, but it gives the outer edges of nose or lips, particularly in this case, this lacking a hard edge or a definite line. And particularly around the corners of the mouth, there's a smudginess. And that makes her look as if she's, well, famously, she's always said to be smiling, or about to speak, or about to smile, or about to respond in some human way to a person. The smile is similar to that we saw on St. Anne and the Madonna, but it's much more complex in this case. Now, Vasari, very helpfully in his book, tells us that Leonardo constantly amused her with musicians and singers and gestures, so that she was always on the point of laughing. And that why he did this was that it took 4 years to paint. Sitting for a portrait, the face goes into repose and can therefore look very melancholic. So whether that's another little myth from Vasari, who knows, but that's what he said. But certainly the mouth does look lively and human and about to respond. The composition is pyramid-shaped. The hands, very modestly crossed, form the base of the figure. And then the figure dominates the landscape in a very monumental way. She almost fills the canvas. Now, the full-length figures of Saint Anne and the Virgin and the Child together filled the canvas, but this half-length figure almost fills the canvas. So she's much more monumental. There are no visible brush strokes because of the way it was painted, with this building up of colour in fine glazes. And that's therefore what caused the first wave of awe at this painting, was the way it solved these purely pictorial problems of painting a lifelike figure. The mystery, though, has intensified in the years since. I just wanted to show you, as I mentioned, Leonardo's interest in geology and rock formations and mountainous landscapes, how far he could take that. In The Virgin of the Rocks, this is the London version, there's also a Paris version, he develops his interest in geology into a, almost like a kind of primeval landscape. Again, a similar type of woman, slightly smiling, gentle, very young. So Leonardo, when you look at his female portraits and his Madonnas, has a type that he represents. So we're just kind of paring away some of the details and getting a little bit closer to the mystery now. Leonardo's interests seem to be very much in geology, in rocks and mountains, in generation of the earth, in birth, in gestation, in human gestation. So we're tempted to ask ourselves, could the sitter be pregnant? Was that the reason for the commissioning of the portrait, the birth of a child? We know from his notebooks that he was very, very interested in anatomy and the gestation of the fetus, and I've put in some illustrations there of, which I'm sure you've seen before, of how interested he was, how right he was about these issues. And then I want to refer back to the beautiful drawing of Isabella d'Este, because she's seen in quite a similar pose. Similarly to Mona Lisa, she's wearing no jewellery. She has a light veil over her hair. And she is thought at the time to have been pregnant. And you can see from all the dates there on the paintings and the drawings and the notebooks that all of these things were swirling around in his mind at the same time in those years between 1480s to 1500. My question is, could this paint, this drawing of Isabella d'Este, which never became a painting, have become instead the inspiration for another painting, for the one we're talking about today? Could it have inspired him to paint a woman in a landscape unadorned? In other words, was Leonardo taking the theological and philosophical ideas circulating around the idea of the Virgin Mary, current in his time, combining these with his interest in the geological origins of the earth, and coming up with a new female archetype, a kind of secular Madonna? Was he centering all of these ideas about the whole of nature in the female figure? I think that's quite a distinct possibility. I think Mona Lisa may not be a woman, she may be woman. And maybe that's how we should look at her. Leonardo went to Amboise in France in 1516 to the court of King Francois I, and he died there in 1519. Thereafter, he brought the painting with him. It never went to the person who commissioned it, if indeed it was Signore Giocondo. And now it belonged to the French king. It was copied or used as an inspiration many times, mostly badly. So you see, genius doesn't go in a trajectory. It can regress. In 1695, the Mona Lisa was moved to Versailles. And by the 18th century, it was so out of fashion that in 1760, it was hung on the wall in the office of a minor royal official. After the French Revolution in 1789, the Royal Collection was opened to the public, and the Mona Lisa was included in an exhibition at the Louvre, the former Royal Palace. Now, I've probably chosen the worst of the copies, just for the joke of it. There were many, many copies. In 1799, Napoleon seized power, and Napoleon hung her in his bedroom until after he was crowned emperor, when he returned her to the Louvre. But however, despite all these copies, bad or otherwise, the only way for the image to become very widely disseminated was for it to be engraved. And here you can see that process happening. And the engraving on the left, which is not good, really. And the problem with the engraving was the sfumato effect that Leonardo had created in the face was notoriously difficult to engrave. However, the dissemination of engravings resulted in the rise of its popularity in the 19th century. And Leonardo himself appealed to the 19th century mindset. He began to be seen as a typical Renaissance man, a modern man of science. He had never painted halos on saints. He had never worked for the popes, unusually. And so he was seen as less religious than, say, Raphael or Michelangelo. He was embraced by the French because, of course, he had ended his life in France in the service of the French king. And so France was his last true home. And the Louvre itself, when it was opened to the public, became the first public gallery in Europe and became famous for its Da Vinci collection through Francois I. Then you had the rise of tourism, which led to a rediscovery of the Renaissance. Another development in 19th century France was in literature and the cult of the eternal feminine emerged, and with it the related idea of the femme fatale. The Mona Lisa fit neatly into this idea and was embraced as part of the symbolist philosophy and lionized as a quintessential woman. Also at this time, Freud wrote about Leonardo's homosexuality and his anxiety at separation from his mother in a 1910 book called Leonardo and a Memory of His Childhood. So all of this coming to the fore in the 19th century would contribute to the lasting fame of the Mona Lisa. Then, on the 21st of August, 1911, the Mona Lisa was stolen from the Louvre. Guillaume Apollinaire, the poet, and the painter Pablo Picasso were arrested on suspicion of the theft. Picasso had been seen every day in the Louvre painting, as artists did, copying from pictures, and so was known as a kind of a vagabond about Paris as well. And they were arrested on suspicion, which added to their already growing notoriety, which makes me think probably Picasso started the rumor himself. It's just the kind of thing he would do. It's just the kind of thing he'd like to be known for. The thief, interesting, in the bottom left to see how the picture was hung at that stage. That you could walk right up to it and no glass in front of it. So 19th century viewers had a far better experience of it than people do today. The thief turned out to be this chap, Vincenzo Perugia, who was a painter and decorator, an Italian who was working in the Louvre, who stole the painting, he said, in order to repatriate it to Italy. The director and the head of security at the museum were sacked, and there was a major scandal in the press for weeks. The Louvre was lampooned in songs and cabaret. Street music sellers sold sheet music for a song called Mona Lisa on a Spree. And her effigy was paraded through the streets of Paris on the annual Lenten parade. 2 years later, he was caught That's his room there. It was found in a wardrobe. And she was brought back, not before touring Italy as a visiting attraction, and was brought back to the Louvre in 1914. And you can see there some postcards from the time celebrating humorously the return of the Mona Lisa. There was even a German film made. I haven't seen it. Geza von Bolvary was the director, but I doubt if it's available on Netflix. During the Second World War, like paintings and galleries everywhere, she was evacuated. You can see her being taken out of her frame and packed up to be taken off. I don't know where the Louvre kept their paintings. I know the National Gallery in London kept some in disused mine shafts in Wales. So they were hidden away from German eyes, or no doubt she'd be in a museum in Berlin now. Her subsequent history, she was attacked in 1956. Someone threw a stone at her, resulting in slight damage. In 1962, she went on tour to the USA. She went to Washington and New York. She had somebody travel with her in the hold, as you can see there, all the way, heavily guarded. And then in Washington, she was seen at a reception with the Kennedys and Lyndon Johnson and the French culture minister, André Malraux, and his wife. And then we see Jackie monalized. On her visit to New York and Washington, she was seen by 6 million visitors. And somebody has worked out that each one saw her for 4 seconds each. She also, in the 70s, toured Japan and Russia. I talk about her as she, as it's like she has become this person. So when, after all of this, when finally returned to the Louvre, the Mona Lisa was housed in a bulletproof box where it remains to this day. She's also been celebrated in popular songs. Nat King Cole's Mona Lisa, Cole Porter, You're the Tops. And she's also been parodied by some very notable artists. This, firstly, by Marcel Duchamp. Now, the title he gives to the painting, these letters, if you say them the way French people, the way letters are said in French, it's L-H-O-O-Q, which corresponds to L-H-O-O-Q, which means she's got a hot ass. That was his joke. He simply took a reproduction and drew on a little moustache and a little goatee beard. Here she is featuring in Kazimir Malevich's composition with Mona Lisa. Malevich, who invented abstraction. So he's making a perhaps satirical or critique of the development of painting. He's rejecting the history of Renaissance painting and saying that squares and stripes are the way forward. And she even appears in Jasper John's Figure 7, the great pop artist. And there she is, sort of eerily peering out and kind of waving to us as well. Also, you'll have seen her everywhere else, on magazine covers, on a British postage stamp. Here she is as a jigsaw puzzle, and advertising, she's advertising Air India, and I quite like the Chanel one. I think that's got a bit of class. So you can see that since the day she was painted, this woman has attracted attention. I told you I wasn't going to answer the question of how great she is. You're all capable of deciding that for yourselves. But I hope whatever you think of her now, you will think a bit harder about her now than what you may have seen behind a sheet of glass in the Louvre. Leonardo, we must remember, never delivered the portrait to Francesco Giocondo. And one wonders why. Was it not like her? Why would a husband not accept a painting he had commissioned? Did it not look like her? Was it not showy enough? Did he want his wife in all her beautiful jewellery and gowns and for their fabulous new palazzo? Was it too experimental? Was it never finished, as Vasari says? Leonardo kept it with him for the rest of his life. That's how it ended in France, in the king's collection. Was it that he wanted to keep it for himself because he saw it as a successful working out of those very ideas I discussed of a new type of secular Madonna? Who knows? I sure as hell don't. Thank you very much for your attention. I am happy to attempt to answer questions if there are any, but as I said, I am not an expert on Leonardo, so that was my get-out clause at the beginning. I much prefer comments and your own views than questions. So if anybody has a view they'd like to give, if you have a question, I'll try to answer it, but if you have a view, I'd love to hear it. There is a chair arm visible, yeah, just. But you see, those problems are because of the darkness. If you remember that those beautiful pale blues in the background of the other pictures, if this were, this is a very controversial issue, the fact that it has never been restored. And restoration in itself is a controversial issue. But it might be nice to see her brightened up. She might look less gloomy. When I was growing up, we had a very cheap framed reproduction of this in our hallway, and I was terrified to walk past her to go to bed because she looks gloomy, but she shouldn't look gloomy. I don't think that was ever part of the plan. That's the darkening of the colour and the varnish. Yeah, probably because of the glass. Yeah. Yeah, well, you were lucky to see her like that. Of course, the problem, and I'm going to sound awful, is mass tourism, which I say everywhere I go, being one of the tourists myself. And I think, I wish the other tourists weren't here. I wish I could see things. But it is the problem with mass tourism that galleries, particularly famous galleries and famous, are just so crowded. You'd go to another, there's a beautiful film called The Venus de Milo instead, if anybody ever remembers that, about a kid who goes to the Louvre to see the Mona Lisa, and this so crowded she goes off in another direction and goes and look. So there's lots of other things to look at, arguably some better, you know, but you were very lucky to have that experience. Yes, the cameras. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And a lot of people a lot of tourists these days. I don't know if you feel the same. You go somewhere and you think, why don't they look with their eyes? They'll go home and they'll look at this photograph and they won't remember having been there because it'll only be a photograph. Whereas your eyes, yeah. And the other thing is, you know, you can go to the museum shop and buy a card or a print taken by an expert with a very good camera that will be much better than anything you get on your phone or your camera. So, yeah. No, not as far as I know, no. Yeah. Yes. Ken, did you want to say something? Sorry, I can't hear you, Ken. I can't hear you. Shout, please. That is a very good question. That's an impenetrable one. Yes, yeah, sometimes. In this case, who knows, because we know nothing about her. It says an awful lot about Leonardo. But without knowing her or anything about her other than her name and a few, how do we know? But yes, it's an imponderable, that whether I think every painting is really about the artist. I think in most paintings, the artist is the subject. Because artists are self-obsessed. And what they're doing is using all of their skill and all of their technique to get out what's inside them. And really, generally, a model is only somebody to hang their ideas on. So, yes, is probably the answer to your question. I'm trying to think of a case. I'm sure there are cases where the sitter was so famous or so well known that they come across more. But no, it's generally about the artist. Yeah. Very perceptive question, Ken. Absolutely. You're talking about the difference between actual space and pictorial space. Because artists have to manipulate and distort peculiarly in order for it to look right. Because the Madonna and St. Anne in that image, yes, you couldn't separate them. You can't see where, because it's not real space. It's a flat surface. And so he's trying to create an illusion of a mass on a flat surface. This is the very reason that in modern times, artists embraced abstraction and refuted this desire, this necessity to create a real space, because it's not a real space, it's a flat canvas. And so you have to do this wizardry of manipulation to make it look right. The worst one is, I don't want to ruin your experience of art, but Botticelli. Botticelli's Venus is dislocated in several places in her body. And yet she's beautiful and magnificent, but she's all wrong anatomically. That's why it's art and not photography. There are different kinds of space and different ways of resolving problems. And the most difficult is a multifigural composition in space, where figures have to relate to each other. Caravaggio, if you look at Caravaggio paintings that have full-length figures, it's quite clear they weren't in the room with him at the time. He painted them one by one. They don't relate very well to each other. Very often he doesn't paint full figures, he just does from the waist up. Leaves out the legs. But it's all about this resolving in space, multifigural compositions. Very, very complex, difficult thing to do. And sometimes to do it convincingly, you have to make it wrong. Michelangelo's Pieta in St. Peter's, where the Virgin Mary is holding the dead Christ. Her legs are, her knees are so far apart, her legs would have to be 6 foot long, you know, to support the, but it looks right. She also looks about 15 and he's 33 and dead and he's her son. But it's not reality. It's creating an impression, it's creating a narrative that tells us a story that has a symbolic truth rather than, and it's not that Michelangelo couldn't do bodies, he could do bodies, we all know, but it was just that, how to resolve it. You're going to look at everything in a different way now. Yes? Well, I haven't read the book that Freud wrote on his sexuality, but I presume he addresses it in it, but I haven't read it personally. Well, he seems to have, while having, I mean, I only mention his sexuality because he clearly had no romantic or sexual interest in the women he depicts, but he clearly had a very great interest in them, because for me, the drawing of Isabella d'Este is sublime. So he clearly had a very great interest in these women. Now, whether Freud's idea of the separation trauma and all of that makes him keep repeating this beautiful, youthful, Madonna-like woman. Freud's own ideas are very questioned now, so yeah, but it's a possibility. You mean, will people still be interested in her? Yeah, hard to know. Judging by the hordes that clamber into the Louvre. But you'd wonder how deep that interest is. I mean, that's sort of, again, being a tourist myself, I don't want to denigrate tourism, but it seems like it's something to tick off on a list when you're in Paris rather than any particular interest in the subject matter. And, oh yeah, I've seen that, I've done that. Whether things, you know, as new things come on board, you see busloads of tourists now coming here to look at the Dark Hedges because of that program, whatever it was called, the Game of Thrones. So yeah, you would wonder. One thing doesn't seem to displace the older, though. So I don't know. Whether painting itself remains of interest, whether art galleries remain open, that's a question. Whether people will much rather go to Disneyland or Disney World than go and visit an art gallery. It doesn't seem to be happening yet, but it could do. There's every likelihood that the history of art won't be taught very much longer. So, yeah, there are questions. Thank you. Brilliant, Alistair. I dropped the... I have to...